2019, Oxford Economics came up with a list of top 10 emerging markets to dominate the global economy. And topping that list was India. And guess who ranked second? The Philippines. This morning, we turn the spotlight on Philippine-India trade opportunities with Mukesh Advani, President of the Federation of Indian Chambers of Commerce of the Philippines. Mukesh, good morning. Thank you so much for joining us. Hi, Mukesh. You're on mute. I think your audio is on mute. There you go. Hi, Mukesh. Good morning.
Sorry about that. No worries. Good morning, Michelle. Good morning to all the viewers.
All right. So I guess let's start.
Thank you for having us.
Yes, thank you for saying yes. I know it's a very busy week and weekend because you've got some celebration to do, but we'll talk about that later. For now, let's talk about the big picture. Latest available data show that bilateral trade between India and the Philippines hit $2.3 billion in 2018 and 2019. India exporting more to Manila than it was importing. And among the top Indian exports, cars, pharma products, rubber, and meat. In return, the Philippines was exporting mechanical appliances, electrical machinery and recorders, as well as pearls and precious stones. Mukesh, I'm curious, how has the pandemic changed the trading landscape, the relationship between the two countries?
Well, definitely with this pandemic, everything has been disrupted. So I think now we have to revisit, you know, all our trade agreements and how we could improve again and build up from, you know, all this lost time.
And what do you think are the key points that we should improve on?
Well, I think it's really more on the relationships. We need to build deeper understanding and engaging more. And hopefully maybe we could have special technical working groups on each sectors where we can build on. That's what I would suggest. Yeah.
And which sectors would you say are the low-hanging fruits? Which sectors can we easily integrate?
Well, of course, definitely the health sectors and the agriculture is really key. You know, food security of the future is really important. And there's a lot of concerns that need to be addressed there, most especially here in our country. Our rice production is quite low. Once upon a time, we were big exporters. And India could basically participate and share its technology and modern programs so that our productivity in agri would keep us, keep the country and its food security safe. And hopefully we can build on that.
Aside from agri, I know that among the big Indian investments in the Philippines would be, or participation, would be GMR of the GMR Megawide Airport Group, the Cebu Airport. You're also big in textiles. Tata Motors is here, Mahindra, also an automobile. And in 2019, Wipro Enterprises acquired beauty products maker, a local one, Splash. You also have the Oyo Hotels. Mukesh, when you talk to the Indian business community, are you sensing a strong interest still in investing in the Philippines? Or are you seeing more opportunities elsewhere?
Well, definitely opportunities are here. Many of the sectors have been untapped. So I think focus between collaborative communications between the two governments still needs to be worked on. Like what I said earlier, maybe each sector that we can improve on could have special technical working groups that could pinpoint and be specific on how we could improve the whole bilateral trade.
I'm very curious. You always ask us for foreign chambers who are in the Philippines. Are there any new names or brands coming in from India or looking to set up shop here?
So far, I'm not privy to that at the moment, but definitely now that things are looking brighter for the future, and with our constant engaging with India and our governments working together, definitely we're going to have many other brands and other opportunities. I feel India and the Philippines have a long way to go, especially as trading partners, And that has to be worked on now after being disrupted these past 2 years.
Mm-hmm. You know, one of the things we can certainly learn from India is your unicorn landscape. India is now seen as a unicorn land. Euphoria is high, and it's no wonder, you know, India gave birth to 38 unicorns in 2020, a pandemic year. 66 unicorns in India have a total revenue of over $15 billion. What can we learn? What can the Philippines learn from India's startup ecosystem, despite, of course, concerns of overstretched valuations here and there?
Well, what I would really recommend is, an exchange or improving the educational program. Mm-hmm. And India could be a big help to the Philippines. And if you notice, a lot of, like what you just said now, a lot of unicorns are born out of India. And I would say the educational system would be best that we could share with the Philippine counterparts, and hopefully, you know, we would have the same number of unicorns coming up, because we're very talented here. But with the exposure and the exchange of ideas and sciences, I think we would be up there soon.
Mukesh, before we went live, we were talking backstage, and you did mention that how big was the Indian community here in the Philippines? Somewhere around the 500,000 mark.
500,000.
Mm-hmm. And for those who are watching us, you were born here in the Philippines, third generation, right?
Third generation.
But you did mention there are a lot of Indian students here in the Philippines. Why don't you tell us more about that, since you're coming from the education integration?
Right. Well, in the past couple of years, a lot of Indian students have come here, especially for the medical and dental schools. Mm-hmm. I guess one thing that we could also share is that a lot of Indian students that have come here have been challenged, because also there's not enough of seats for those students in India. And we are very blessed that they've come here. And like what I said again, our medical system and dental system has been excellent. So they have been coming, and hopefully we will have more students coming in the future.
Okay. Final question, Mukesh. I know it's going to be a very busy weekend, because you guys are celebrating the 70th anniversary of the Chamber. What sort of activities do you have lined up? How busy is this weekend going to be?
Well, we're already celebrating. By tomorrow, we're going to have a big gala night. And we are going to be honoring some of our government officials with the Golden Peacock Award. Well, the Golden Peacock Award is because the peacock number one is beautiful. And it's, again, it's India's national bird. But the symbol of it is all about outstanding qualities of people, their leadership, their loyalty, and all the hard work that they put in. So we felt it would be a perfect time, after coming through all these challenging times, fighting COVID, we are going to honor a few of them, and honor also the members, and celebrate the 7 decades of what the Chamber has done throughout the years. So we will look at the past, and then honor them, and then we will all work together for a better future. And hopefully we can bring and be more impactful to the country.
Mukesh, I'm very curious, which government official does the Chamber feel outperformed during the last 2 years of this pandemic?
Well, there's a few of them, especially when it comes to the health protocols. Secretary Galvez and his team, they've stepped up.
Mm-hmm. Mukesh, you're on mute again. Sorry. All right. So you've got Secretary Galvez.
We're honoring about eight or nine government officials. Yes.
Okay.
Maybe I would suggest that you join us and on the event is going to be live. So maybe let's keep that as a surprise.
Okay.
But definitely, we are honoring them for their outstanding leadership and performance in response to COVID-19.
Okay, at least we got one name out of the 8 or 9, Secretary Galvez.
At least there's someone you got.
Okay, Mukesh, thank you so much for joining us and for the insights. Congratulations, 70 years. And here's to the next 70. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.